Almost everyone in the United States at one time or another has traveled at least a stretch of old Route 66. It is one of the most famous highways in the world.
It's the road where the people from Oklahoma went to California. It's a part of American history.
This broken chain of concrete and asphalt has served as a source of inspiration for literature, music, drama, and a nation of dreamers.
This is the road that opened the western part of the United States to the rest of the world.
There she is, folks, the land of milk and honey.
When you get down on Route 66 and look at the history.
To me, it's going back and back in time, seeing things that I grew up with and things that are rapidly disappearing.
Just the name conjures up images of going somewhere.
I'm Michael Wallace.
And I'm Suzanne Wallace, and we've spent a lot of time on Route 66.
Come along with us down the Mother Road from Chicago all the way to Santa Monica.
January 17th, 1977, the weather was typical for Chicago in winter as Gus Schultz and John Chesniak entered Grant Park, leaned their work letter against a light pole at the corner of Lakeshore Drive and Jackson Boulevard, and took down the last signs posted there that marked the path of U.S. Route 66. After decades as America's most famous highway, after carrying hundreds of thousands of people across the heartland of the nation, an American institution had come to an end. Route 66 had been decertified. The legendary highway was dead. America's Main Street was entrusted to the history books. But in fact, the highway was not dead. Far from it. This venerable road was about to start a whole new life, another incarnation. To know the story of the Mother Road, you must go back to the America of the Roaring Twenties, when we were between wars and on the wagon. Calvin Coolidge was president, and Henry Ford had just changed everyone's lives by lowering the price of his motor car. Until that time, there were almost 3 million miles of roads in America, but they were only fit for horse and buggies. Just 1% were able to accommodate the wear and tear of automobiles, and those roads were mostly in the cities. So as motor travel began to stir the public's imagination, pressure was put on politicians to build a year-round, practical highway that would link the country. But where to put the new highways? What cities would get the best roads? By 1925, the job of choosing the new highways went to a group of various state highway officials and others, which included an untiring Oklahoman named Cyrus Stevens Avery. Avery would eventually become known as the father of Route 66 for his dogged persistence in establishing what he felt was the perfect route joining the East and the West. Instead of adapting the traditional northern path, which followed the historic Santa Fe Trail, or the forest southern route, which tracked the old Butterfield stage line, Avery envisioned yet a third route. His would run between the other two, roughly along the Old Gold Road, west from Fort Smith, Arkansas. It just happened to go right through his adopted hometown of Tulsa, Oklahoma. On November 11th, 1926, after 2 years of bickering and compromise over routing and highway designation numbers, state and federal highway officials met in Pinehurst, North Carolina, and signed off on the interstate routes for all 48 states. Avery's choice, eventually called 66, was among them. The highway that connected two-thirds of the continent wound out of Chicago and traversed the gently rolling Illinois farmland. After it crossed the Mississippi River near St. Louis, 66 closely tracked the old Osage Indian Trail and the Wire Road as it cut across the Ozark Plateau of Missouri in a southwesterly direction. It briefly nipped a corner of Kansas before marching across the oil fields and ranch lands of Oklahoma. After reaching the Texas Panhandle, Route 66 sliced through Amarillo and then shot straight into the mountainous country of New Mexico. Beyond Albuquerque and Gallup, the highway moved through northern Arizona and the towns of Holbrook, Winslow, Flagstaff. It crossed the Colorado River and entered California at Needles, and then snaked across the Great Mojave Desert of Southern California before reaching the Pacific Ocean at Santa Monica, west of Los Angeles. In all, it moved across more than 2,400 miles, three time zones, and eight states, touching the very heart of America. As Cyrus Avery had planned, it would become one of the very first continuous spans of paved highway linking to the east and west. But more than that, Route 66 became a mirror held up to America. It put us in touch with one another through its necklace of neon lights, Burma-shaved signs, curio shops, and motor courts. Today, Route 66 means a time before America became generic, when motels didn't take reservations and doctors made house calls. Some things never change. Even in the modern era of jumbo jets, shopping malls, and super slabs, people are turning back to the past. Those of us who truly love Route 66 prefer life on the mother road. We get off the turnpikes and interstates, slip onto Route 66, and return to the way America used to be. Mother Road begins or ends depending on which direction you're going, in front of the Chicago Art Institute on the edge of Grant Park. It then ran due west out of the Loop District until it reached Ogden Avenue. Historically, those motorists who chose to join America's Main Street in Chicago then cut southwest along the city's business route, across the sprawling suburbs of Cicero and Berwyn, before snaking south along the Pontiac Trail toward the prairies, farms, groves, and coal mining country of Illinois, the land of Lincoln. The litany of towns and cities that traveler encounters in Illinois include many that were named for prairie families, early pioneers, or old Indian warriors. Most of them, like here in Pontiac, feature more than one alignment of the old highway. Over the years, the pavement was rerouted as cities grew and traffic patterns changed. Here, you can see several alignments of the old road within sight of a later version. But sometimes, the different alignments take a little detective work to locate. But then, that's the fun of tracking Route 66 and discovering the Mother Road.
Route 66 and trucks seem to go together hand in hand. They always have. And where would trucks be out on the Mother Road without a good old truck stop? And here we are today at one of the best, one of the earliest ones, the Dixie Truckers Home near McLean, Illinois. This was not only one of the first truck stops in the land of Lincoln, in the state of Illinois, but probably one of the first, if not the first, truck stop on the entire length of Route 66. And it's still here today doing business, just like it always has, just like it has since 1928. Route 66 was only 2 years old, an infant, when they opened the doors here at the Dixie Truckers Home.
Well, this particular truck stop's like a home away from home for drivers. The early days of the Dixie used to be, it was a two-seater restaurant, two-seater operation. The drivers would take turns waiting in line to get a seat so they could have coffee. It's been a stop for years and years and years.
These are our last cowboys, our last Don Quixotes out on those big trucks cruising down the road, tilting at windmills. These truck stops mean a lot to them. And the good truck stops like the Dixie, they keep going forever and ever and ever. If the coffee's hot, if the food's good, if the service is quick, there's a friendly smile inside. That's what counts, and it means a lot to a trucker. It pays off in big, big dividends.
From the Dixie Truckers Home, Route 66 Road Warriors continue on their southwesterly trek once again. They pass through the state capital in a city chock full of monuments and memories of Abraham Lincoln. After Springfield comes a slew of other quiet farm towns, and also the famous Our Lady of the Highway statue on Francis Martin's farm near Raymond. Beyond are the towns of Litchfield and the Ariston Cafe, Mount Olive, site of the famous Soulsby service station, and several other strong highway towns that cling to the Mother Road as it makes its way toward the Mississippi River. Chain of Rocks Bridge opened in 1929. It was a $2.5 million two-lane toll bridge that carried Route 66 traffic across the Mississippi until the 1960s. This is one of the few bridges in the world with a radical bend in the middle, and it's still a favorite, although it hasn't carried traffic in many years. Today, it is still possible to walk along the same narrow pavement that helped thousands of road warriors across the Mississippi for decades. Walk over a dirt barrier and gaze through a cyclone fence at its rusting iron spans. Vines and brush consume this old relic of 66 that served as one of the many Route 66 crossings. Today, Chain of Rocks remains as a silent tribute to the glory days of Route 66. And for a moment, out here, pausing high above the Mississippi, just might hear the whispers of a thousand ghosts along the Mother Road. Now, of course, there are faster, more direct, and safer bridges across the Mississippi feeding into St. Louis, the largest of the Route 66 cities between Chicago Los Angeles. Down along Chippewa Street, a Route 66 alias in the city, during the high summer, chances are folks will be stacked up 10 deep at the row of windows at Ted Drew's frozen custard stand. I grew up in St. Louis and was weaned on Drew's custard. Whenever Suzanne and I return for a visit, we come here to sign books, see old friends, and of course, fill up on the ambrosia that Ted and his troops still create on premises.
Ted's father really got the whole family business going way back when, back in the early days, not too long after Route 66 was christened. That was, of course, 1926. He's not tampered with the recipes or the architecture, those wooden icicles that he keeps up there.
It's not a cookie-cutter kind of a place that you can find anywhere along the highway. There's only one Ted Drew's, and it's the best.
Just a short distance beyond Ted Drew's wait more memories of the heyday of Route 66. Coral Court, just outside St. Louis city limits, is a noteworthy survivor. This Art Deco motor court is currently closed, but it has been spared from the wrecking ball for now. There is no wonder that the streamlined, modern-style architecture with rounded, buff-colored walls, glass-block windows, and lintels and parapets of red tile did a booming trade out on Route 66. Adjoining garages, which allowed guests to enter their rooms in complete privacy, also made a hit with couples interested in an illicit rendezvous or smooth-talking salesmen who had gotten lucky for the night. The Coral Court was the proverbial no-tell motel, but one with a touch of class. Beyond the city, long segments of 66 remain in places like Times Beach, Eureka, Pacific, St. Clair, and Stanton. Like the interstate, the old highway crosses Missouri diagonally toward the high plains southwest of Springfield. For many miles, in both directions, travelers here encounter colorful billboards extolling the finer points of one of the most famous Route 66 attractions and one of the first, Merrimack Caverns. Drive about 3 miles off Route 66 down a twisting road that leads to the Merrimack River, and you'll find the humble entrance to a vast maze of caverns that were first developed commercially in the 1930s by Lester B. Dill. "I've put more people underground and brought them back out alive than anyone else on Earth," he used to brag. He's probably right. So far, nobody has disputed Dill's claim.
Merrimack Caverns is a classic Route 66 tourist attraction. I'll even go so far to say it's a tourist trap, and I mean that out of pure love, because it's a very loving place. This is a cavern, a natural cavern that's been commercialized and passed on for several generations from the 30s to this very day by the first the Dill and now the Torelli family. We've got actually the grandson of Lester Dill, the man who commercialized this cave. Now we've got his grandson running this cave.
My grandfather used to say that what really sells this cave is mystery, romance, and beauty. And as long as you keep those three things going, you're gonna do well. And I think if you take the tour, you'll see that all three of those ingredients are here in this cave.
This is the cave where the bumper sticker was invented. I don't know if we should bless them for that or curse them.
I started here, as did everybody at the time. Your first job when you started was a bumper sign boy, and you worked your way up to a cave guide. And I started in 1/4 of July. I put on 527 bumper signs, and so I'm quite proud of that fact. My grandfather was too.
Highway is not a thing of the past. It's a thing of today. It's a road to adventure. It's exploring America. It's remembering a lot of our past, our history of the 20th century. And those remnants are filled with stories of their own, and you can almost hear them as you stand and look at them and explore them.
Road warriors were always attracted to the highway. You can still be seduced out here today. This section between Rolla and Springfield is famous among Route 66 roadies for its river bluff scenery and a lovely old steel truss bridge that dates back to 1923. Back on Route 66 in central Missouri, today's road warriors find themselves cruising deep into the Ozarks, past Lebanon, Springfield, the queen city of the Ozarks, and through the shadows of the impressive courthouse in Carthage, Missouri, hometown of the bandit queen Belle Starr. Down past Webb City, a once rich mining town, the old road works its way toward Joplin, and the last stop in Missouri. Route 66 is only an unimproved two-lane with no curb and no shoulder as it cuts into Kansas, the third of eight states it will cross on its way to the Pacific shore. The center stripes have long ago faded here as the mother road makes its way across just a little more than 14 miles of the Sunflower State, country that turned into a bloody battleground in the late 1930s. There are no monuments or markers here on this road, on Route 66 in Kansas today. There's nothing to tell us about what happened here back in the turbulent 30s, when this was bloody 66. The blood from miners was shed on this road as they went on strike. John L. Lewis was the head of their union. And truckloads and carloads of labor scabs came up and down this road. They were from Missouri and Oklahoma and from right here in Kansas. And they went to battle against the company boys in front of the Eagle Pitcher Smelter, right into the town of Galena over that graceful sweeping bridge, where nine of those men were gunned down in 1937 right in front of their union office. It was a terrible, terrible time. Time that we shouldn't forget. So maybe we don't need the official marker or the monument. Maybe the monument's here after all, right there in that two-lane asphalt road, Route 66. There is a memorial to this Kansas town, however, the Galena Museum. The old train depot was moved to the edge of the highway, and Howard Litch and other local citizens began preserving memories of the old mines and the well-used highway the town still loves. These memories are their monument to 66. Leaving Galena, Route 66 makes its way across the Spring River into the quaint town of Riverton. If you're hungry, why not try Eisler Brothers' store for a handcrafted sandwich that would make Dagwood green with envy? And for dessert, there's plenty of real conversation from the fiercely proud Kansas people who cherish their stretch of 66. Out here in Kansas, it's much easier to find remnants of the old road. The highway shields are now painted right on the pavement. It's a sure way to know exactly what highway you're on. Dead ahead lies the historic town of Baxter Springs, Route 66 plows right through the first cow town in Kansas, which was located at the end of the famed Shawnee Trail. This is where, on a quiet May afternoon in 1876, Jesse James and Cole Younger calmly wandered into the local bank. They pulled their guns and withdrew almost $3,000, then jumped on the waiting horses and made a dash into Indian territory. Their route paralleled the Mother Road as it streaks out of Kansas and into Oklahoma. Nowhere is Route 66 more at home than in Oklahoma, where the pavement follows the contours of the land as though it's always been there. 4 miles south of the Kansas border, the first town on US 66 is Quapaw, a mining settlement named after a tribe that moved to Indian Territory in 1833. Then comes Commerce, another old mining town that is best remembered as the boyhood home of Yankee slugger Mickey Mantle, and where locals named the route Mickey Mantle Boulevard. 3 miles farther south, and the old highway enters Miami, where a major Mother Road icon endures, the remarkable Coleman Theater. The Spanish colonial masterpiece, covered with intricate terracotta gargoyles, opened in 1929 and instantly became a theatrical landmark in the Southwest. Will Rogers, among others, performed here at the Coleman, now preserved for future generations. Near Miami and the town of Afton are good examples of the one-lane route, complete with curbs. This sharp piece of the highway was the last part of Route 66 to be paved in the state. Even today, when travelers meet oncoming traffic on the narrow stretch, both road etiquette and common sense need to prevail. As the old highway moves farther southwest into Oklahoma, it serves other staunch highway towns, Veneta, White Oak, Chelsea, and Bushyhead, before reaching Foyl, a farming hamlet that was home to a part Cherokee farm boy, Andrew Hartley Payne, the winner of C.C. Pyle's International Transcontinental Foot Race. Staged in 1928, this race became known as the Bunyan Derby and helped put the name Route 66 on the map. To highway travelers who venture just a few miles from 66 at Foyl, they may visit Ed Galloway's 90-foot-tall tribute to Mother Road tourist stops, his Totem Pole Park. The stunning main totem pole and the other figures that grace the park, created by Galloway, have been restored, and the site remains a tranquil setting for travelers who wish to take a break before moving on to Claremore.
We're in Claremore, Oklahoma, a very important Route 66 town for many reasons. This is where Patti Page was from, the great warbler. This was the home of Lynn Riggs, the poet and playwright whose Green Grow the Lilacs spawned the great Broadway hit Oklahoma, Rodgers and Hammerstein. And here we are at Will Rogers Memorial. This is where Will, America's great humorist, is resting forever, since his death in 1935 at Barrow, Alaska with Wiley Post. On these 20 acres at the Will Rogers Memorial, just a mile off Route 66.
Rogers loved this country, and his name even became synonymous with the fabled road. Sometimes it's called the Will Rogers Highway. Just west of Claremore, on the Will Rogers Highway, there is a once popular tourist spot that still garners its share of attention.
That blue whale is a charming character, isn't he? He's been here for a while, several decades, and he looks a bit forlorn now. He's getting a little long in the tooth. That blue paint is fading, but he's He's still another major Route 66 icon. The Blue Whale's famous up and down 66 between Chicago and Santa Monica. And for many, many years, he lured people off the Mother Road, and they could come in there and take a dip, jump right off of his tail, right up off of his lip, into that cool water and refresh themselves, wash off a little road dust.
The same people owned a zoo of sorts right next door.
The Ark, the animal reptile kingdom, and they had snakes and alligators and all sorts of critters to look at. They were careful not to mingle those collections with the bathers, however. But it's our hope that maybe this will come back to life, and I think it will. I think you're going to see that pond water cleaned up a bit and dredged, and I think you're going to see a new coat of paint and some new life added to that whale, and maybe the luster will return. I hope so.
The luster has already returned to another Mother Road landmark. It's perched on a gentle rise just across the highway from the Blue Whale.
Well, of course, the trading post has always been an important ingredient in the great American West in the scheme of things. It was the store. It was the place that native people came in and actually traded, swapped things they made, crafts and art and items and icons and so forth and images, and walked away with everything from coffee to blankets and victuals and so forth. Well, we don't quite do that here today, but what these good turistas are doing, these tourists, these road travelers, they're exchanging currency and plastic and walking away with treasures that have also been crafted by native people. To me, this is the quintessential Renaissance business on Route 66 on the Mother Road. This is a business that's been brought back to life with all of this resurgence of interest in traveling the old road. And to many road warriors, it's become kind of a sacred temple that represents all of that.
From Arrowwood Trading Post, Route 66 runs toward Tulsa, Oklahoma's cultural capital, once called the oil capital of the world. And then west again through 100 miles of old Indian territory. In Oklahoma City, the east and west collide on Route 66. This is the crossroads of America's Main Street, where through the years, tourists, migrants, and so many others have funneled into. Less than 3 years after the highway was officially open, the Roaring Twenties lost their force. The economy began to crack, the stock market bottomed, and the nation plunged headlong into the years of the Great Depression. Starting in the brutal summer of 1930, unprecedented drought besieged farmers in the Midwest. On April 14th, 1935, a huge black dust storm blew out of western Kansas, crossed Oklahoma, and moved over the Texas Panhandle. It looked to eyewitnesses like the end of the world. To the disenfranchised who traveled west, following the sweet smell of orange blossoms, Route 66 became the proverbial Dust Bowl Highway. For the poor dirt tenant farmers whose lives and fields had literally blown away, there was no time for fun and games on the road. For them, the highway was a migrant's path which they believed would take them to a better life in the fertile fields of California. Cruising on west out of Oklahoma City, the old highway still skirts Lake Overholser on its way toward Yukon, and further west, El Reno. In El Reno, along the shoulders of the Mother Road, sits the Big Eight Motel, advertised as Amarillo's finest. The Big Eight slogan puzzles many folks since Amarillo is still 250 miles ahead in Texas. But the sign was a gift from Hollywood when United Artists Studios came here to make their film Rain Man. Since then, the motel has become quite a tourist stop. Each year, thousands of tourists come to see Room 17, where Tom Cruise and Dustin Hoffman stayed. Past El Reno, the old highway heads toward the gently rolling farmlands of western Oklahoma. Near Bridgeport, the two-lane drops into a valley and crosses the south shore of the Canadian River on a mile-long bridge. Generations of travelers have counted the spans as they cross, hoping to tally all 38. Here, as is the case elsewhere on Route 66, especially in the rural areas of New Mexico, crosses festooned with plastic blooms stand in silent tribute of those who perished in accidents on the highway.
In Clinton, Oklahoma. We're in the heart and soul of Route 66 country. It doesn't get any better than this right here. It's because of the gang that makes up the cooks and the waitresses and the bus people are here. They're unlike any others. So there really isn't another one. They can't franchise Pop Hicks. You can't bottle Pop Hicks, you understand. So there's only one.
What's he say, 35?
We all make it now. Good to see you. Enjoy having you.
Santa Maria up the coast.
Well, that's gorgeous, yeah.
Have you ever been to St. Louis, Missouri? Have you ever been to St. Louis, Missouri?
Yeah, I got down there one time.
What they do have in common here at Pop Hicks with some of the other greasy spoons and cafes and places where they dispense soup and chili and burgers down the road is they have people here who know how to have conversation with you, who come up to the table and look you in the eye and say, "Hi, honey, how about some more coffee? Or where are you going? Or where are you coming from?" And there's none of this, "Oh, I hope you have a nice day. You know, I'm Bart and I'll be your waiter today." We know this woman's the waitress because she's got a coffee pot welded to her fist. There's no question about it, you see.
Is there a special on Wednesday nights?
No. So then it goes back again to where you don't notice it, right?
You're prettier than ever.
Well, thank you. Oh, thank you.
So that's what goes on in Pop Hicks. That's what it's all about. As I've often said, I can't imagine the world without those Pop Hicks.
Yes, this is the way I treat my health.
West of Clinton, the highway starts a gentle southwest descent through lands studded with yucca and prickly pear, past Chanute, Elk City, Sayre, and Texola as it races on toward the Texas Panhandle. Interstate 40 spans the Panhandle like an endless slab of monotony. While Old 66 used to cut a 180-mile swath across seven Texas counties and offered diversions along the way. The first big spot west of the Oklahoma line is Shamrock. Named by an Irish immigrant, Shamrock evolved into a thriving oil town in the center of the rich Panhandle field. By 1936, the skyline boasted the distinctive Art Deco tower of the U Drop Inn.
Back in Route 66, heyday, Shamrock, Texas was really a going place because it was the main stop they used between Oklahoma City and Amarillo.
Sure.
And we really really had everything going for us back then. Good old days, as they all talk about them.
Well, and I think those good old days are going to come back here to Shamrock. I know you've got plans now to put up more signs. You're talking about creating an Edsel graveyard. And,
yeah, we've got an Edsel graveyard in the makings, and across the street over here, we're going to put in a cable tool drilling rig, which is part of our past. And then on down the street, we're going to have we're going to name it the Good Old Days Park. We have the Route 66, the original dirt moving equipment we're going to have down there, and our old original jailhouse from Shamrock, and old farm equipment and far trucks back in the 30s and 40s. It's still a good tourist town, well, I mean, and we get a lot of tourists from all over the world here.
That's great.
Our tourism is our best business we've got here, the only business we've got here. We enjoy visiting with tourists. And
well, that's the way it should be. Why don't we go in here and see if we can tangle some chicken fried steak?
Okay, that sounds like a good deal to me.
Make Shamrock, Texas a must stop on your tour of the Mother Road as you journey across the Panhandle. Continuing west, another section of the old road appears in McLean, a town that began around 1900 when cattle chutes were built near the Rock Island Railroad tracks. One of the very first Phillips 66 stations in Texas was built here at McLean on the shoulders of the Mother Road. Gas no longer flows from the pumps, but what better reminder is there of Route 66 heyday here in the Texas Panhandle? Travelers who choose to leave the interstate and cruise through the streets of McLean are in for a treat and just could learn something about the ranch country here.
Devil's Rope. You know what Devil's Rope is? It's barbed wire. That's what they call it. And if you want to know why they call it Devil's Rope, you need to come down Route 66 and stop in McLean, Texas.
The most significant thing about barbed wire is that on the plains, there was nothing to build fences out of. There were no rocks, no rail fences or anything. So they had to come up with an efficient means to fence. At the time barbed wire came into existence, slick wire without barbs on it,
yeah,
had been around quite a while.
Sure.
And the cattle and the livestock, they just rubbed on it and scratched the flies off and went through it and were gone. All of a sudden, it had barbs on it.
Uh-huh.
And they weren't aware of this. And so, sadly, there were a lot of livestock hurt by running into the wire and were injured. And there was some religious groups and groups that didn't like barbed wire that said, oh, this is the work of the devil. So, this is the devil's rope.
Traveling on west across the flat Texas Panhandle, the first real city the westbound traveler encounters is Amarillo. And no traveler down the old highway or Interstate 40 today can pass through the area without noticing billboards that tempt hungry vacationers with promises of a free 72-ounce steak to anyone who can eat it all within an hour. Many decide to pull off the highway and into a survivor from Route 66 that continues on the interstate, the Big Texan Steak Ranch.
Welcome to the Big Texan. $5 here. We hope y'all enjoy your dinner. Watch out for that 72-ounce steak in there now.
I couldn't eat it.
Over the years, many people have taken the management up on their challenge. Some succeed. But eating 4.5 pounds of meat is no easy task. And if you're going to try, there are rules to the contest. Owner Bobby Lee, whose late daddy founded the eatery, is there to enforce those rules.
Wait a minute, partner. Now listen. You got to make sure you understand the rules of this beef contest. You have to eat the shrimp cocktail, roll and butter, baked potato, salad, and the 4.5 pound side of beef in 1 hour. Once you start, you can't leave the table.
How about a little 72-ounce steak eating music there?
Sounds great. Go for it.
That'll here we go there, partner.
Of the thousands of diners who've tried to devour their gargantuan steak, only a few have staggered out of the Big Texan with as much money in their pockets as when they came in. Among those who've succeeded, a gent from Shamrock who does it periodically, but always with his teeth out.
This is a lot of steak.
A 63-year-old grandmother and an 11-year-old boy who proved to his parents that his stomach really was bigger than his eyes.
How much time do I have left?
Your time's about up.
I'm almost there. Just wait. Hold on.
Another one bites the dust.
It's time to hit the road once again, this time heading through downtown Amarillo. The city itself was laid out in 1887 and was named Amarillo, the Spanish word for yellow, because so many of the homes here were painted that color.
We made our first trip together on Route 66, actually from St. Louis to Amarillo in the late 60s. I can remember staying in Amarillo in a hotel on the old strip on Amarillo Boulevard, as a matter of fact. And we were on our way from St. Louis to El Paso, Texas. And we began to talk about that, making that journey, that definitive journey down Route 66 in the late 80s to really photograph it and see what the real state of affairs was and to talk to the people. That was the main thing, talk to the people. Put together a scrapbook, a love letter of our own for Route 66.
As you follow the interstate west past the city limit signs, there stands a bizarre pop art monument to the Mother Road. It's one no traveler should miss.
Well, let's see here. Trying to figure out why anybody with a reasonably sound and sane mind would cross an old wheat field where a lot of cows tend to jungle up and mess around to come out here in the middle of nowhere on the edge of Amarillo. What could possibly lure all of us out here? It could be 10 cars nose down right in that Texas turf. Stanley Marsh's Cadillac Ranch. That's what it is. So this is what it takes to get people out on the western edge of Amarillo, Texas. These 10 Cadillac automobiles. Models from the late 40s through the mid 60s, through that great heyday of Route 66. And Stanley Marsh III put them here so they can not just capture tumbleweeds blowing across this wheat field around the cattle, but so that people from the interstate and from beyond over on old Amarillo Boulevard, AKA the Mother Road, Route 66, would come over here and go through that break in the fence and come down that dirt path and pay homage to the era of the great Detroit sled, of the big car, of the wide open spaces. And I can't tell you how many people have stopped here. Some of them scratching their heads, not knowing why, but they come here anyway, and they leave their generation of graffiti, their initials, tattooed in those old cars.
And what I've been enjoying doing is we come by here at various times, different seasons, different years, is to photograph some of the messages up close. Pink Floyd messages from this summer. People signing it and telling when they were here and why they were here and reminiscing. So I'm beginning to, just as there are individual Cadillacs, I'm beginning to find some individuality each time we come after Stanley has repainted them.
Stanley Marsh planted his caddies in the Texas Panhandle, a truly remarkable place that is also known as the Llano Escondido, or Steak Plains. This area, stretching into New Mexico, is so flat, and there are so few landmarks that early travelers had to drive stakes into the ground to mark their trails.
West Texas can be an empty land, or it can be just as full as a tick hanging off a longhorn in the middle of the summer. It just depends on how you perceive it and look at it and take it in. A lot of people drive through West Texas and they think it's desolate and barren, just like the Mojave. But those of us who get out on Route 66, where the road goes through the ecology of the land and you're not separated like you are on the interstate with those great banks, we know that there's life not only in that great Mojave Desert and the other southwestern climes, but here in this supposedly barren Texas panhandle. There's winter wheat percolating under that ground right now. There are whole legions of longhorns and heifers and Angus feeding all over these lots. There are the ghosts of so many cowboys and Comanches and pioneer settlers and native people and all kinds of folks who have traversed this land when there was no path at all, and those who made the path, and then those who chiseled out that Route 66 for us. There's a lot of life out here. There's a lot of legend. You'll find that it's alive and well and kicking. There's a lot of life in the Texas Panhandle, a lot to be seen and shared.
There are also ghosts and places that ghosts prefer to inhabit.
You know, a lot of people like to come here to Glen Rio because this is a ghost town in the making. This is one Route 66 town that hasn't quite made it. There are more dogs here now than human beings. All the businesses are closed, the curio shops, the gas stations, the cafe that used to serve so many travelers. But somehow it's a bittersweet feeling in Glen Rio. We need a little bit of this ghost road as well. So this alignment's kind of nice to remember the way it used to be, the way it was. This is the place, right back here, where you can stand with one foot in Texas and the other foot in New Mexico, right here on Route 66. And so it's still good for that. It's good to have a picture made and maybe just stop and listen to the water dripping in the background of the old tank. And in August, you can hear the song of those locusts from the Chinese elms. It's not bad to have a little bit of sadness, too, on your journey. Makes you stop and think.
We leave Glen Rio and motor west into New Mexico along the old highway. Five states are behind us now, and three more are ahead as we follow the mother road to California. Here in the land of enchantment, Route 66 has changed very little in the years since Steinbeck's Jode family passed by. Between the Texas border and the Pecos River lies a section of New Mexico that once was home to large buffalo herds and became the hunting ground of Comanche warriors. It was a land roamed by Spanish conquistadors, American settlers, gunfighters, and later cattlemen. At many points along this route, you can still search out relics from the Dust Bowl days. For many, the interstate that replaced Route 66 out here was heaven sent. They remember the old road between the Texas line and Tucumcari as dangerous. It was narrow, pocked with holes, and generally not well maintained. Many people died on this stretch of the mother road. It was said that there was only a few inches in a cigarette paper between you and death on Route 66. Needless to say, travelers along this road were glad when they made it to the first big town in New Mexico, Tucumcari.
Tucumcari tonight. That's what those big red and yellow billboards still say. 2,000 rooms. Tucumcari, New Mexico has always been one of Route 66's best place to jungle up for the night, to slip in here and get a cheeseburger platter or get your first taste of New Mexican cuisine and certainly to get a room. What a great spot. 2,000 rooms going and blowing in Tucumcari, New Mexico. And we're right here at a national treasure in more ways than one. This is the Blue Swallow Motel. For more years than I can remember, the Blue Swallow's been here. this pink adobe building with the little cottages trimmed in blue paint and with the neon blue swallows. This is Route 66 Nightlight. It's a Lorelei that still lures truckers and tourists off the highway, off the interstate, back to the mother road. And it's owned and operated by a real angel of the road, Lillian Redman.
This was one of the leading motels because it was out here on the highway. And the celebrities like to come here. Route 66 is coming back. We've gone just as far and as fast as we can go. And we like all that high-tech, fast travel. But they've gone so fast, they're going to have to slow down. So Route 66 is their alternate. They get off the highway, the interstate, they relax a little bit, and they get down on Route 66 and look at the history. They enjoy it. You'd be surprised.
Once Route 66 road warriors get a good night's sleep in one of Tucumcari's 2,000 motel rooms, they go back to the pavement once again, towards Santa Rosa. During the time of the great Dust Bowl migration, the old highway crossed the Pecos River near Santa Rosa, where, when 66 was first created, the route then turned north and headed up into the New Mexico high country, into the ancient state capital. Here we are in Santa Fe, New Mexico, the city of holy faith. Here in the land of enchantment, the land of poco tiempo, little time. What an extra special place this is. And for many years, this was a Route 66 town. There's an alignment of the old highway running not far from here. Because well into the late 30s, Route 66 actually crept up towards the mountains, towards the Sangre de Cristos, visited Santa Fe, and then went to Albuquerque. After that, it made a beeline from Santa Rosa right down into the Duke City, into the biggest city in New Mexico. So Route 66ers still count Santa Fe as one of theirs. In order to preserve these pockets of Mother Road lore and culture, I write about Route 66, while Suzanne captures the essence of the Mother Road with her camera.
Photographing Route 66 is a challenge because a lot of what is most beguiling to me as a photographer is in a state of ruin, you might say. The older buildings, the faded signs. The highway is not dead, and that it's not gone, that there is a lot out there, that it's alive and full of adventure. Fun. Come out here and discover it.
By 1937, Route 66 had bypassed Santa Fe altogether, saving travelers as much as 4 hours between Santa Rosa and Albuquerque. That stretch eventually became Interstate 40, as it carried motorists past Moriarty, Edgewood, Barton, and Tierras before dropping down into Albuquerque. The Duke City has always been an important trading center that dates back to 1706 when the Spanish came north from Old Mexico along the Chihuahua Trail. Just jump off 66 as it passes near the Old Town District, and you'll see for yourselves remnants from the past.
Albuquerque, New Mexico is one of the large cities along Route 66. And even though the heart and soul of the Mother Road is in the small towns and hamlets and villages along the way, these big cities are still important.
From Albuquerque, the old road crosses the Rio Grande, heads west up Nine Mile Hill, then crosses a vast and varied land colored blood red, jet black, purple, and brown. Ahead is the valley of the Rio Puerco, carved by a stream that rises out of the Jicarilla Apache lands and flows south into the Rio Grande. At the Rio Puerco crossing, the old road traverses a steel bridge, then continues west near Correo and into the Laguna Indian Reservation. Route 66 is at its very best at this point. Thanks to the builders, the roadway honors the land and adjusts to the terrain, skirting around mesas and ruins. It did not chisel into buttes and mountains or interrupt entire cultures like the interstate has done. The Mother Road crosses the San Jose River and curves into Laguna, an Indian pueblo dominated by a distinctive mission church. Yes Brown lived in Laguna while the interstate was being built. He's still there today.
It's not really progress, but, you know, there's a lot of stuff, you know, that we lost too, you know, like on the freeways and all that. You know, we got a lot of spiritual, you know, places and all that too. We lost that too.
From Laguna West, the road takes travelers to Budville, Cubero, San Fidel, McCarty's, and Grants. More small towns beckon, and then there's the Continental Divide, the highest point on Route 66, 7,275 feet above sea level. In no time, road warriors will make the Arizona state line. But there is still a romp through the rest of New Mexico, and the last town, Gallup. Gallup is a railroad town and one of the great Indian trading centers of the Southwest. Route 66 was built right through the heart of Gallup, a town that has always had an affair with railroad buffs, highway voyagers, and neon. Then it's time for a good night's sleep in the Indian capital of the United States. And the promise of Arizona and another state to explore is 26 miles to the west. When John Steinbeck's Jode family made their trip down 66, the highway through Arizona wasn't even paved yet, and the entire route wouldn't be until the late 1930s. At that time, plenty of surprises met the Okies as they ventured west.
Where are you going?
California.
How long you plan to be in Arizona?
No longer than to get across.
Got any plants?
No, no plants.
Okay, go ahead, but keep moving.
We aim to.
There is still an inspection station near the border, but the rude inspectors who greeted the Okies are gone. Nowadays, gas stations and curio shops line the interstate at Lupton, where red sandstone cliffs skirt the border with New Mexico. Arizona is one Route 66 state loaded with tourist attractions. From the border, the old highway climbs west toward the towns of Holbrook and Winslow, and between the two, there is the famous Jackrabbit Trading Post near Joseph City. Halfway between Winslow and Flagstaff, you can see traces of the old Mother Road. This is Two Guns, where Old 66 once ran over an unusual bridge that spanned the infamous Diablo Canyon. Here there was a zoo, where caged mountain lions and other wild critters were displayed for awestruck tourists. The animals are gone, but not the visitors, who still stop to pay homage to the old road. On the way west to Flagstaff, you'll pass Twin Arrows, a trading post and truck stop with the look and feel of the old wayside businesses. Soon the desert gives way to pine forests as the pavement follows closely to the Santa Fe Railroad tracks. The highway climbs through the Coconino National Forest, not forgetting tiny Winona, the last name on the map before travelers enter the unofficial capital of northern Arizona, Flagstaff. After leaving Flagstaff, the highway moves through the snow-covered pines of the Kaibab National Forest on its way to the town of Williams at the foot of 9,264-foot Bill Williams Mountain, and named for the colorful trapper who first explored the region in the 1830s. It was here in Williams that the last section of U.S. Highway 66 was replaced by the interstate. On October 13, 1984, Williams was given the dubious distinction of being the last town on the old highway to be bypassed. It was behind a locomotive much like this one on September 17, 1901, that the Santa Fe first began taking tourists to see one of the great natural wonders of the world, the Grand Canyon. For the next 52 years, trains bound for the South Rim left from the station here at Williams. In 1953, steam passenger service came to an end. Fortunately, not forever. Today it's back. Eric Eikenberry has watched the rebirth.
Well, this railroad has really put us on the map. In addition to all the railroad buffs, all the people that want their kids to have the experience of riding a steam train, the whole Old West nostalgia, the atmosphere, it's just a natural. With 10 million people now practically visiting the Grand Canyon, and with traffic such a problem up there, this is a great way to go up to the canyon.
It makes you feel like you're back in the old days. It's a nice, comfortable ride. It's slow. It brings your pace of life back down. If you've been driving on a vacation, get on the train, you feel good again. You get comfortable, and you see the sights at a nice pace so you can actually see them.
Whether you take the train or go by car, no Mother Road adventure would be complete without a side trip to the Grand Canyon. Even on a foggy day, the experience is one you'll always remember. Shortly after the last stretch of Route 66 was bypassed near Williams, Arizona, many felt that the book was finally closed on the Mother Road. They predicted that the old highway would become a sad footnote to history. But as Suzanne and I were soon to discover, it was just the end of one chapter and the beginning of another.
It was the discovery of the passion in the people that had stayed right there next to the highway, kept their businesses alive. People were all along the highway wanting for it to be America's Main Street again and working hard at trying to make that happen.
Nowhere is that more evident than here in Seligman, where each year they hold a Route 66 fun run, the largest public display of affection for the old road you're likely to find anywhere. Angel Delgadillo has been cutting hair right on the shoulders of Old 66 for many years, and is pleased and proud to see the highway become popular again.
It still looks the way it did then, and the world just loves it. They just literally love to come to Seligman and Toe Falk and Kingman and Ash Fork, and they want yesterday. We are yesterday. These buildings here, we the people, we are yesterday.
Good trip. See you down here.
Seligman sets the scene for the rest of the mother road through Arizona. Route 66 today, where it's still possible to get out there on the open two-lane blacktop, roll down the windows, crank up the radio, and see the West the way it was meant to be seen. Highway winds through Deep Springs, Truxton, dips past Valentine, Hackberry, and negotiates the longest continuous curve on a U.S. highway before running straight as a yardstick all the way to Kingman. Kingman is another one of those steadfast Route 66 towns. During the annual fun run, this is where road warriors turn into the city park and show off their classic machines.
That's 57 T-Bird. We've owned it for 13 years. We drove Route 66 from Dwight, Illinois to Flagstaff in it last summer.
1931 Buick. Runs great. Drove it to Denver last week.
Well, we have a 1955 Pontiac that belonged to my grandmother. It was bought new for her in 55 by my father. If you like the car, I'd like for you to see the trailer. And my husband, Bob, will tell you about that.
What we have here is a 54 Ford styled rear end, complete fiberglass trailer. The boat on top is removable. You can take it off, sleep in here. Got a small closet in the front and a chuck box area in the back. It's a toilet. That's it. It's all you can say about it. You need it once in a while, so I got it. I put that on there myself. That's an aftermarket item.
From Kingman, Old 66 Highway passes through the striking Sacramento Valley before it begins its arduous ascent up the old Gold Hill grade toward Oatman. By today's automotive standards, the steep grade doesn't look so difficult. But in the old days, it was immediately obvious why so many lowlanders feared this stretch of the highway, considered the steepest part of the entire route. There are stories of travelers freezing behind the wheel, trying to back their cars to safety. Some tourists even paid hard-earned vacation bucks to salty locals who would drive the family sedan over the mountains. But once the highway tops at Greaves Pass, it was downhill all the way to Oatman, a gold mining town that to this day will not die. Thanks to flea market choppers and tourists who find pleasure in feeding the semi-wild burros that wander down Main Street, Route 66 has not overlooked Oatman. Even on a busy day, it's an ideal place to stop for a while, savor a bit of the West, and think back on history.
Right at the turn of the century, gold was discovered in this vicinity. And from that, it just kept growing in the whole area until there was several million dollars worth of gold taken out here at its peak, which was in the teens, basically, up until World War II, when the president signed an executive order saying that all gold mines must close. Then it kind of became a ghost town as such. Not a true ghost town, because there were always a few people living here.
Billy Joe Moore once owned the Oatman Hotel, where, believe it or not, in 1939, Hollywood movie stars Clark Gable and Carol Lombard spent their wedding night, and where some say their ghosts linger. From Oatman, the old road runs south out of town, down a gentle slope past Mesquite, Yucca, and Greasewood on its way into the valley of the Colorado River. Beyond, the Okies and early travelers could see the golden land called California waiting for them on the other side. When Steinbeck's Jode family finally reached the Colorado River, they shared the same mixed feelings that many of the Dust Bowl migrants must have felt after such a grueling journey.
Well, there she is, folks. The land of milk and honey, California.
The Jodes passes away in the 1930s when Route 66 across the Colorado on an arch steel bridge. Now a newer span, just to the right of this scene, carries Interstate 40 across the restless river. But the old bridge is still there, now used to carry pipelines into California. In California, Route 66 developed out of a dirt and sometimes wooden plank trail that followed the railroad tracks across the Mojave Desert. From the river, it followed a circuitous route toward Needles. Needles was an early desert crossroads named for the sharply pointed peaks of the Black Mountains of Arizona back across the river. In the older parts of town, there are still reminders of the years when the Mother Road carried traffic right through Needles, not around it. Some of the old motels still exist and have been updated to bed and breakfast inns. Hank Wilde just remodeled the old Trails Inn and has seen a rebirth of his hometown.
Route 66 is starting to pick up our business here in the community, and hopefully we'll be able to build on that.
But historically, Needles has been said to be the hottest place on earth, so hot it can make a rattlesnake sweat.
It does get a little bit hot here, but you know, we don't have snow up to the ears of a giraffe, you might say. We have a couple of months of somewhat uncomfortable heat, but then all of Needles is air conditioned.
Although Needles, like the rest of the desert country, may be sweltering, to this day, the tourists are still coming. But most pause just long enough for food and fuel, and maybe a good night's rest, before heading out to what many consider the most dangerous desert on Earth. West of Needles, the highway climbs steep grades onto a plateau and then heads west across the desert toward Essex, Amboy, Daggett, and Barstow. This was some of the most desolate land the Mother Road would cross, and it still is today. Beyond the grade, the Mojave turns into bleak flatlands where at dusk temperatures start to become halfway civil, and in the winter it gets bitter cold. Out under the heavens here, travelers can see forever. For many miles before reaching Amboy, the names and initials of passing travelers appear on a narrow berm of sand alongside the highway. The letters, words, and messages are usually created with rocks, as if people needed to leave a part of themselves in the desert and let others know that they've been there. This long, lonely Mojave stretch between Needles and civilization is still considered one of the most grueling legs of the entire Route 66 journey. By the time the Jode family reached Barstow, they'd traveled almost 2,000 miles, and the promised land was literally within sight. In the 1930s, most Dust Bowl refugees chose to leave the Mother Road at Barstow and head west toward Bakersfield at the southern end of the lush San Joaquin Valley. But to those who stuck with Route 66, they would next have to curve southwest out of Barstow along a plateau that gently rises toward the distant San Gabriel Mountains on their epic journey to the Pacific Ocean. It is only a few more hours now, and the journey will be over, far from the dust and despair, in a new land where many travelers still hope to launch new beginnings. Before the coming of the interstate, motorists descending the old route through the steep Cajon Pass were forced to use second gear all the way as they wound down towards San Bernardino, the seat of the largest county in the nation. But once the superhighways were built, traffic was drastically slowed on the old road. For the iconoclast, the old highway offers a sense of the past and is the preferred path to the Pacific. Bill LeFevre, who often travels the Mother Road by himself on his trusty Harley, likes to watch trains from this section of the road called Blue Cut.
Well, it's my roots, I believe, because I was born in Pasadena, California in 1946. And when I first began to drive in February of 1962, I had a 54 Ford that I bought from my dad. And as you'll recall, Route 66 was a pretty popular song on the radio back in those days. And I can remember driving along, listening to that song on the radio. Plus, I'm a railroad fan, and a good majority of the east-west railroad traffic goes along Route 66. To me, it's going back and back in time, seeing things that I grew up with and things that are rapidly disappearing.
San Bernardino. Only about 70 miles left to go. But following the old highway through the congested suburbs of Los Angeles today can be frustrating. Time has not been especially kind to Los Angeles. Since the 1950s, the City of Angels has become shrouded in smog and crime. A concrete jungle of freeways and multi-lane superhighways spread across the metropolis, destroying much of the romance that was once Route 66. Then, at last, comes the distinctive smell of the ocean. Finally, after traveling more than 2,400 miles through 8 states and 3 time zones, this is the payoff, Santa Monica. Twilight is the best time to be here, when the sunlight is scarlet and golden, and joggers and tourists sometimes pause at a small plaque set in the ground where the highway ends. This is the Will Rogers Highway, it says, dedicated to the humorous world traveler and good neighbor. The first road he traveled in a career that led him straight to the hearts of his countrymen. The same can be said of many who have traveled the Mother Road.
Well, this is it. This is the end of our journey, the end of our trek down the Mother Road, down Route 66. We're at the end of the highway, the end of this great east-west path that begins in Chicago but ends here in the land of hope, the land of promise, the land of milk and honey, California, Hollywood, Beverly Hills. It's all around us, but we're nestled in Santa Monica, an old, old coastal town that embraces the Mother Road and serves as a fitting place to end our trip. We can't go too much farther west. We've got the Pacific Shore there. So we're here in Palisades Park, 26 acres of eucalyptus and date palms and tea trees, mockingbirds, gulls, a few homeless souls that conjure up images of the Joads and the Okies who went down the Mother Road. This is the place, Southern California, that embraced all those road warriors before us. It's a place that promised things to people, sweet oranges, a chance to be in movies, maybe just smell the sea and take a look even farther west. Folks are still doing it today, this many years later, out on Route 66. I think it's been a good trip. I think it's been a good journey. It's a trip I won't soon forget. And I want to leave you with these words, my good fellow travelers. Just remember, Route 66, the name is still magic. Route 66, it will always mean going somewhere. Travel well.